It is about that time. The first day of the NHL regular season. Toto, we are no longer in Kansas anymore. The summer is done. Regular season has begun. Welcome on into season two, episode one of NHL Puckline. I'm Lauren Jbara. That's Todd Fuhrman. And Todd, we're back, baby. How you doing? How was your summer?
I'm good, Lauren. I've missed you. It's a great opportunity for us to dive right in, talk a little NHL regular season hockey. And it feels like just yesterday we were finishing up all the Stanley Cup shows and everything else. The offseason, it's officially in the rearview mirror. Teams have to try and figure out who they're going to be. And of course, that starts tonight. My summer was great. Had a little chance for R&R, but let's not kid ourselves, Lauren. We've been in mid-season form trying to dissect the NFL, college football. The NHL is just another layer of opportunity we'll have on the betting board each night.
Absolutely. There's so much going on right now, but it is happening. Today's the day. Day one of the NHL regular season, and the league has gifted us with not one, not two, but tres games tonight on the slate, and I am so excited about it. First of all, the Predators taking on the Tampa Bay Lightning at Amalie Arena, and then all eyes are going to be on the 8 p.m. Eastern time game on ESPN. The Blackhawks and the number one overall draft pick in Connor Bedard making his NHL debut in game one, taking on Sid the Kid, the old kid, taking on the young kid. And then last but not least, we got hockey after dark. The Seattle Kraken take a trip to Vegas, the Las Vegas Strip, where the Vegas Golden Knights, the reigning Stanley Cup champions, will be raising the banner to the rafters. And Todd, I heard you're going to be in attendance for that. Are you excited?
Of course. Now, the only thing I'm wondering, Lauren, is I've been waiting for my Stanley Cup ring that all the Golden Knights, members of the organization, the players all unveiled on social media on Monday. They must have forgotten my address. I'm not sure if Bill Foley is watching this show every day alongside us, but I'm more than happy to share my contact details. I'd love to be able to wear it as a ring, put it around my neck as a pendant, but no doubt a special day on the Strip, as you mentioned, to raise the banner. And you know what? You get to be Stanley Cup champions until the puck drops on the next season. So once that banner is hanging in the rafters, it's all about business for the Knights, as they know everyone in the league will be trying to knock them from their perch as league champions.
Absolutely. They got about 5 hours and 28 minutes to be exact to still be the reigning Stanley Cup champs. And then the new season begins. If you haven't watched Puckline before, or if you're a returning viewer to the show, guess what? We got a surprise for you, because last year we had Tuesday, Thursday shows. This year, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, we'll be bringing you all of the action, all of the best betting lines, all of the best analysis right here on the NHL YouTube page and also on all of the other NHL platforms. So we're so excited to be with you 4 days out of the week, every single week throughout the regular season. Can't get enough of us. I know. Like, guys, are you excited? Todd, are you excited? Come on now.
The reality, Lauren, is we're going to split time. So the viewers are going to get plenty of you. They're only going to get a half week with me. At the same time, though, to your point, couldn't be more thrilled to be able to take Puckline from 2 days a week into four. There won't be a game that we don't cover in some capacity. So regardless if you're a fan of the Golden Knights, you find yourself hoping that this is the year that the Maple Leafs finally break through, or you're part of a rebuild in Philadelphia or San Jose, rest assured your team will not be neglected in any capacity as we try and find angles and advantages worth attacking from a betting perspective.
Absolutely, we do and we will. So let's get right into game one. We have the Nashville Predators on the road taking on the Tampa Bay Lightning at Amalie Arena. The Preds kicking off their 25th anniversary season, and they have an early game. It's going to be 5:30 p.m. on ESPN. Now, the Lightning, they were great at home last season, 28-8-8 record, 46 wins overall. The Preds, decent last year, 42 wins overall, 20 on the road. They finished fifth in the Central Division, and they missed the postseason. But for Nashville, they're kind of rebuilding, kind of not. I feel like a lot of their success this season is going to be based on a lot of their young guys. How are their young guys going to produce, especially with a new guy at the helm and Andrew Brunette? What do you think the spark, like, what do you think is the spark that a guy like that is going to provide for this team, especially a lot of these young guys who are really getting that experience in the first couple of years in the NHL?
I think Predators fans should be excited about the mix of talent. Not that they're going to compete, in my opinion, with the Colorado Avalanche and the Dallas Stars to win the division this year. But you look at a roster that showed nothing but grit, tenacity, and fight down the stretch, despite being undermanned. I mean, we said it half jokingly when we previewed a lot of the late season games for the Predators that it was a combination of an NHL roster with the Milwaukee Admirals, given all the players that they dealt at the deadline as part of the rebuild. So what do? You go out there and you bring in a consummate veteran like Ryan O'Reilly to play on the first line. Maybe you get increased health from Philip Forsberg and he can flirt with 30, 40, or 50 goals if he's able to play a full 82 games. But most importantly for the Preds, you get a player back on the blue line who missed the latter portion of the season in Roman Josi that's an absolute game changer. And the one thing about Philip Forsberg, outside of what he brings from an offensive capability standpoint, Lauren, there may not be a better mustache anywhere in the league than what Forsberg brings to Bridgestone Arena on a night in, night out basis. But I think the other part about it, when you see players like Tomasino, Novak, and even Evangelista who were forced into action on the first line, they're going to be much more comfortable as part of a third line pairing going into this season. And we know the floor is always in a good spot when you have a backbone like Juuse Saros, who's going to log 60 to 65 games as he always does and give you Vezina caliber production most nights he's out there.
Absolutely. You look at this graphic here. Philip Forsberg last season, he played 50 games, 19 goals, 23 assists, 42 points, and he's feeling good heading into the regular season. So I'm excited to see what he can do. When you look at him and some of his futures, is there anything that kind of stands out to you in terms of what you would take before the regular season starts when it comes to Philip Forsberg being a guiding force for this team?
You know I'm going to sound like a wet blanket more often than not, Lauren. I root for nothing to happen in a lot of the hockey games I watch. I bet a lot more no's in some of the prop markets that are out there. I look to bet teams on these point totals because more often than not, things that can go wrong do go wrong. And it's not just something in the NHL that relate to the Nashville Predators. It's professional sports in general. So while I want to be optimistic that I think Forsberg can achieve decent numbers in terms of his goal-scoring prowess, his injury history concerns me some. So he's not a player that I'd be looking to target in any of the futures market because I do have to worry about that level of durability. Now, if you were looking elsewhere at some of the odds in terms of Predators' overall production, maybe you explore Norris bet on Roman Josi. We saw what Erik Karlsson did last year in San Jose, putting up 100 points, and he got legitimate consideration. I mean, Josi is the guy that anchors that power play, and a more offensive-minded style with Andrew Burnett on the bench, there's a chance that Josi can put up gaudy numbers. So if I'm looking at any season-long prices that relate to Nashville Predators, Josi to win the Norris would be the one that I'd be closest to considering. But full disclosure here, I don't have a ticket on that particular bet, and it's something that I'll watch throughout the early portion of the season.
Okay, we talk a lot about Nashville. Let's take it to the other side, the home team, the Tampa Bay Lightning right now. With them, I feel like they've slid down a little bit, especially on the defensive side. It's not as good as when they won back-to-back cups, right? So I feel like their defense is going to be the big question for the Tampa Bay Lightning this season. And obviously starting the season without Andrei Vasilevskiy, he's out after his back surgery for multiple weeks as well. But you look at their numbers last season. Last year, the Lightning offense was great. They averaged 3.41 goals per game. It's the defense that really needs to make a push. What are your expectations before we get into the nitty-gritty of the Lightning overall this season and what you expect from them heading into game one?
You know, I'm not as bearish, Lauren, right now as the betting market is on the Lightning, but I do have some legitimate concerns. And you mentioned the injury to Andrei Vasilevskiy that's going to keep him shelved probably for the first 2 months of the season, if not longer. So in steps, Jonas Johansson, who's essentially been a journeyman netminder during his NHL career. And when you look at Johansson's numbers, 35 NHL games. Yeah, exactly. NHL. It's recalibrating the brain more than anything else. But Johansson's given up 24 goals above expected. And I'm not sure he's going to be able to take the mantle and be a true number one. So that's an immediate concern that we're going to pay attention to early. You look at some of the subtractions there, and that was a lot of grit and muscle. Veteran presence in Corey Perry and Pat Maroon. Alex Killorn, of course, gets the big deal from the Anaheim Ducks. He's going to be on the shelf, though, early in the campaign. And I wonder about some of the additions. Tyler Motte's a nice player, but I'm a little bit surprised that the Lightning have to trot him out there inside their top six. So if Tampa is going to be successful, they're going to need that top line to produce. If Nikita Kucherov, Braden Point, and Steven Stamkos. But you look elsewhere down this lineup, and I think they're going to have to take on a lot more of a defensive posture to try and protect Jonas Johansson, especially early on as their starting netminder. And they're, of course, going to need Victor Hedman to return to form. But this is a roster that has played a ton of hockey over the last couple of years. When you win back-to-back cups, you come up just short against the Avalanche. So maybe a longer offseason, exactly what the doctor ordered. but I expect them to be involved in a lot more low event outcome games, meaning they're going to have to focus on their defense and hope that top line can create a little bit of offense while they wait for Andrei Vasilevsky to return.
Yeah, you talk about that top line. Let's get into Kucherov a little bit, because last year, 100-plus point season, 113 points to be exact, 30 goals, 83 assists. You talk about them producing. What are your expectations for him leading this team this season? And do you have any futures bets on a guy like Nikita Kucherov? Because, I mean, you look at this odds right here, 20-1 right now, or 200 to win the Memorial, the Hart Memorial Trophy plus 2,000 at this point. I cannot speak right now, Todd. I don't think, my goodness.
Look, Lauren, here's the thing. These NHL teams get 5 preseason games to work out some of the kinks. You and I are expected to be in midseason form right from episode 1 on opening night. So, you know, if there's a neutral zone turnover, we're not getting pucks in deep, it's obviously going to lead to odd man rushes going the other way. But Nikita Kucherov, in terms of his odds to win the Hart, it's 20-1. Not a big enough price for me to try and get involved. You see his overall statistical profile from a season ago, and you look at his over-under for goals this year set in the mid-30s. I mean, I know Kucherov has missed some extended time over 2 of the last 3 seasons, but he's taken on the role of a much more of a facilitator than anything else. And I think that's a market that I'd feel more comfortable looking to try and bet his point total over more so than going to goals. But again, they're going to get every other team's top defensive unit against them, knowing that Tampa is going to need to manufacture goals throughout the lineup. And I look at that second, third, and fourth line. They don't scare you the same way that they did when this team was making deep runs in the Eastern Conference and they were winning Stanley Cups. So you're going to need 91. You're going to need Braden Point, and you're going to need Nikita Kucherov to be at their absolute best. So I would lean under his goal number currently set at 34.5.
When you look at the spread for this game right now, obviously the Tampa Bay Lightning, the favorites in this one, Nashville Predators plus 134 on the money line, total set at 6.5. That game is going to be at 5:30 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN. For you, Todd, that's like 2:30 p.m. You can have your lunch and watch a hockey game too. Why not? Well, we're going to be right back here on Puckline. But first, a word from our friends. Don't go anywhere. Miss us. Welcome back to NHL Puckline. Lauren Jbara and Todd Fuhrman here. And obviously, the game that everybody's talking about, all eyes are going to be on 8 p.m. Eastern time, the Chicago Blackhawks taking on the Pittsburgh Penguins, because Connor Bedard, the most highly touted prospect in a very long time, is about to play his first game of regular season NHL action. And if it's anything like we've seen during the preseason, he's had 5 points in 4 games. Granted, only one of those being a goal, and it was an empty net goal, but at the same time, 4 assists. He's really facilitating for his teammates. And the NHL, Todd, sets this up perfectly for us.
Clean down low.
It's the new kid, the young kid, playing against the old kid in Sidney Crosby. And Sid was Connor's idol and favorite player growing up. We couldn't set it up any better.
No, you're exactly right. But one thing I've learned, Lauren, apparently if you want your son to be a good hockey player, the best place to start is naming him Connor. You have Connor Bedard, who is the odds-on favorite to win the Calder. You have Connor McDavid, who's the favorite to win every single other award. And if that's not enough, Connor Hellebuck gets a massive deal from Winnipeg, and he's a co-favorite to win the Vezina. So apparently Connor's synonymous with hockey greatness. But I think other than the storyline with Connor Bedard making his debut against Sidney Crosby, is don't forget the Blackhawks were the team that essentially ended the Pittsburgh Penguins season last year. Pittsburgh was almost a $5 favorite in that game when they came up short against the Blackhawks. We know how unhappy Sid was missing the postseason, so there is no doubt a level of retribution that the Penguins will be seeking tonight. And while I think Connor Bedard can answer a lot of the lofty expectations that oddsmakers have for him with his point total set in the high 60s, right around a $1.25 favorite to win, you know, a little bit of hardware in his rookie campaign, this is a Blackhawks team that's really going to struggle. You look up and down that roster, and Bedard and Taylor Hall are nice 1-2 pieces to have on that top line. You have some grit on the fourth line. It appears Corey Perry and Nick Foligno will be down there. And you want players like that, the longtime agitators that can protect the centerpiece of the franchise. But I look at this team on the blue line and I have some major concerns. For me, Seth Jones is a fringe number one defenseman, and there's not a whole lot of depth. We look at the goaltending situation with Peter Mrazek and Arvid Soderblom below league average in that regard. So I think the Hawks will be hard-pressed to meet some of their preseason expectations. And when we look at Sidney Crosby and what his team did in his first season, we look at Connor McDavid and what the Oilers did in Connor's first campaign. Both of those players had teams came in under their projected point totals. I think the Blackhawks could be in a very similar bucket, but that doesn't mean that this team won't be must-see TV every night we're out there as we all await Connor Bedard to score his first NHL goal.
Yeah, they had less than 30 wins last season, but I feel like they've had a lot of really good new additions. You mentioned it. Taylor Hall, Corey Perry, Nick Foligno. They're going to be good additions for this team, definitely. But then you look at their blue line. Right now, they're probably going to be starting three rookies on the blue line. They need to get a little bit of that NHL experience under their belt. And that might take a while, just forming that chemistry with these new guys on the same team. I definitely think they're going to be better than they were last season. But I guess time will tell, right? It's like we only have to wait 7.5 more hours before we kind of know what to expect, because at this point, it's all up in the air. We don't know what to expect from a lot of these different rookies that are going to be starting for the Chicago Blackhawks team. Now, on the other side, you look at the Pittsburgh Penguins and you kind of do know what to expect at this point. They're a team full of guys aging like a fine wine. Let's start it off first with Sidney Crosby. This dude's almost 40 and he's still producing like he was in his mid-20s. Is he ever going to age, Todd? Truly, is he ever going to age?
I mean, look, Father Time remains undefeated for a reason, but Sidney Crosby appears hell-bent on holding him at bay as long as humanly possible. And while Sid may not be the perennial MVP candidate for the heart that we've seen in the past, his hockey IQ allows him to offset some of the diminished skill set that we've seen. And on any given night, Sidney Crosby can be the best player out there. When I look at this Penguins roster, I really like their top six. I think it's as dynamic as you're going to find throughout the league. When you talk about Jake Gensel getting healthy, Sidney Crosby centering that line between Brian Rust as well. And then, of course, Riley Smith comes over from the Golden Knights, Evgeny Malkin, and Rickard Rakell, maybe one of the more unheralded players in a top six across the league. The problem is I just don't see a lot of depth scoring that the Penguins are going to be able to manufacture. So at least to their credit, Kyle Dubas has built a third and fourth line that have an identity. That identity, in my opinion, won't be scoring goals. It'll be taking on much more of a defensive stance. And on the blue line, you add a player like Erik Karlsson. He's going to make the power play more dynamic. Yeah. It takes some of the pressure off Chris Letang to generate offense. But again, we always seem to default to goaltending and health. Let's see if Tristan Jarry can be out there and log a full workload. His last couple of seasons have been marred by injury. He's in and out of the lineup. They brought in Alex Nedeljkovic to take over as the number two goalie from Casey DeSmith. And I think this Penguins team can be good, but you're going to have to identify opportunities to bet them in some spots. That aging roster is not going to fare well when they have schedule congestion, playing three games in four nights, 4-6. But they're going to play with a sense of purpose. They don't have the non-playoff berth last year sitting front and center for no reason. Yeah. I think you're going to get an inspired Penguins team early. And look, there are no nights off in the Eastern Conference. It's deeper than I can remember. And I think the Penguins will go out there and play with a sense of purpose, but I'm not ready to buy into them completely as a legitimate Stanley Cup contender just yet.
I'm buying in just a little bit. Just a little bit, not a lot, but just a little bit. I love the veteran experience on this team, and adding Erik Karlsson, I think, is going to be a massive piece. He was a 100-plus point player last season on the blue line. I think he's really going to add a different dynamic to this team. But again, between the pipes, Tristan Jarry, it will be interesting to see what he can do. He only played 37 games last season, 2.90 goals against average, 909 save percentage. So we'll see how this season plays out. I know the Pens have been sitting there marinating all summer on missing the postseason because of the Chicago Blackhawks team. And now this new look Blackhawks team this season is ready to go. They have a lot of young guys that are ready to get after it. Four rookies probably are going to be starting in this game tonight. So it'll be interesting to see. And obviously all eyes are going to be on Connor Bedard. That game is on It is at 8 p.m. Eastern time, you know, on ESPN.
That you mentioned about the Blackhawks and some of those rookies. I think some of the guys are flying a little bit under the radar since Connor Bedard will have all eyes on him. I'm curious to see how another top 10 pick and Filip Korzynski does, makes the team out of camp. Yeah. They're going to have him on their second blue line pairing. those are the players, to your point, that are going to have to gel and mature under the bright lights. And the other problem that may work against the Blackhawks early in the year, look, the league wants to showcase superstars, and who can blame them? But playing on national TV more often than not with a roster that may not match up against some of their counterparts means that a lot of these teams are going to give their Blackhawks their best shot. And I'm not sure, especially early on in the season, the Hawks will keep anybody at bay.
Blackhawks with 26 wins last season. We'll see if they can tick it up a couple more this season. That game's at 8 p.m. Eastern time, game two of the three games on the slate. We'll be right back with more NHL Puckline. We have our Hockey After Dark game on the slate today. Game three of three. The Seattle Kraken heading out to T-Mobile Arena in the Vegas Strip to take on the Las Vegas Golden Knights, the reigning Stanley Cup champs, for the next 5 hours until the first puck is dropped today, starting game one of the regular season. But this one is going to be excited. I know Todd is excited because he's going to be in attendance to see that banner being raised. Your expectations for Vegas this season, because right now they're top eight to go back-to-back and win another Stanley Cup champ this year.
Yeah, I mean, look, Lauren, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I didn't buy into this team last year at the All-Star break. I was reluctant to do so at the start of the postseason. You know, I had all of my futures exposure on the Edmonton Oilers, but the Knights proved me wrong. But you know what? I'll probably go in with the same slightly pessimistic outlook this year for this Golden Knights roster. When I look at their point total, I actually think it's a touch inflated. I know they bring back a lot of their key contributors from last year's Stanley Cup run, but already they're dealing with some injuries on the blue line. Zach Whitecloud going to miss some time. Alec Martinez out. So that third pairing will be largely inexperienced. And I do wonder about a roster that got a few bounces when they needed them most last year. Now, I know Bruce Cassidy has them playing with a defensive mindset. You reap what you sow, and a lot of that defensive structure paid dividends. But I was truly surprised that the Knights made such an aggressive and generous deal towards Aiden Hill to bring him back to split time with Logan Thompson this year between the pipes. I think it's always more difficult once you get to that mountaintop to kind of stay there. And the Knights will have a giant target on their back on a nightly basis. And I actually think odds makers are forcing you to pay a bit of a premium through most of the markets. Maybe not the odds to win the Stanley Cup, where they're slightly disrespected there. But in terms of their points, their price to win the Pacific Division, and even their price on opening night against the Seattle Kraken team who they finished the regular season against, I think Seattle is going to have something in store for them in the season opener, knowing those legs can get awfully heavy when you're standing out there with all the passion and circumstance around raising a banner to the rafters.
Yeah, and honestly, with this team too, you have the least amount of rest this entire summer, but they are going to feel good, rejuvenated. You mentioned Aiden Hill. Very lucrative two-year deal, if you will. Is he going to be the same from postseason? Obviously, he had a .915 save percentage during the regular season. That was upped to .932, the Vegas Golden Knights, hoping he stays there. Matty Beniers, fresh off of his first Calder Trophy, hoping to have a big year this year on the other side, the Seattle Kraken. Let's get into him, because Seattle was the talk of the town last season. They surprised a lot of people with what they were able to do, being an actual contender, and a lot of the same pieces, as well as the few new additions in some depth pieces too, are going to be good for this team this year. But again, Matty Beniers, fresh off of his Calder Trophy, 24 goals, 39 assists, and a plus 14. Do you think he can keep up that pace or up it in his second year in the league?
You know, Matty Beniers is an interesting case, because when I look at some of his peripherals, he did what was asked of him last year, but I'm not sure he is a true high-end number one center, at least right now. Those numbers there were good. He did what was asked of him from Coach Hackstall's bunch. But when I look at Seattle's roster from top to bottom, the sum of their parts significantly better than any individual piece. And that's a credit to Ron Francis, the way he's kind of built this roster. But the biggest concern I have for Seattle coming into the year, you look at their shooting percentage as a team of 10.4 at 5-on-5. That was an analytics era record that I'm not quite sure is repeatable or sustainable. So So how does Seattle maintain their perch in terms of relevance in the Pacific and get back to the postseason again? They're going to need to be better on the power play and take advantage of some of those opportunities there. I do think getting a healthy Andrei Burakovsky back may as well be the exact same as a free agent addition, as he was leading the team in goals before he was forced to miss the majority of the season. I look at this team on the blue line, and while there is some depth, I think the loss of Carson Soucy is bigger than people want to illustrate. But I do think Philip Grubauer gives them a backbone that they can lean on a little bit more. We know Grubauer in his first season between the pipes as a member of the Kraken didn't go out there and perform like I'm sure the front office in Seattle or Kraken fans were led to believe. But he showed flashes of returning to his form a little bit. You look at his season-long numbers, goals saved above expected, nothing to write home about. But he single-handedly went out there and stole the series against his former team in that first round of the playoffs with the Colorado Avalanche. Chris Drieger comes back, and we'll see what kind of form he can show as a true number two netminder. But I think what's interesting, the Kraken, for me, maybe more than any team in the Pacific Division, have boom or bust potential. So you saw them at 100-plus points at a price of plus 250. That's not a bad bet, in my opinion, because I don't think I'd want to tango with the Kraken's over-under for points, knowing that this is a team that can underwhelm, but if they hit their stride again, they do have a little bit of a higher ceiling because they're not reliant on one individual to take over games. And while I think the Pacific will be improved year over year, I think this Kraken team is built the right way. And if they're in contention right around the trade deadline, maybe Ronnie Francis goes deep into that farm system in Coachella Valley and he's willing to add a little bit of a reinforcement.
Yeah, you mentioned them on special teams. Their power play has to be more efficient this season. They were 20% or less during the regular season and postseason. They need to get that up to at least like a 25%, one every four. But we'll see what happens. Obviously, they're plus 140 on the money line tonight. Vegas Golden Knights, minus 170. That total set at 6.5. And when you have Mark Stone coming into the season fully healthy, Conn Smythe winner Jonathan Marchessault looking to build off a great season, it's definitely going to be a tough task for the Seattle Kraken tonight. Todd Fuhrman is going to be in attendance. Todd, I hope you have fun at that game. That's going to be a blast.
You know, I will do my best, Lauren. I'm not sure once that banner goes into the rafters where my loyalty will lie for the better part of 60 minutes. Wink, wink, nod, nod. But it won't stop me from rooting for the Golden Knights to try and be atop the Pacific Division at the end of the campaign. But you know me, wallet over heart every night of the week now that the NHL regular season is back in full force. Couldn't be more excited to be able to do this show with you again and talk about a lot of the marquee players, marquee teams, and the inevitable storylines that we'll be following from now until the end of the regular season in early April.
Me too. People are going to get sick of us by the end of the regular season. This Kraken Vegas game is at 10:30 p.m. on ESPN, so make sure to tune in for that. So much to look forward to. This is the NHL Puckline. We got Jack Eichel tonight, 10:30 Eastern time. We're so excited. Monday through Thursday, Puckline, every week. We'll see you then.